Hi, I am Leif Lindbeck, and I am responsible for this course in network programming. So it is me that you hear in the videos, except for the video on multithreading and the video on Android. Those have been recorded by Homan Peder Sajjad. So I wish you very welcome to the course, and let's get started. First, let me explain what this course is all about, what is its scope. So, to avoid confusions, I will first tell what the scope is not. So, it is not protocols. We will not study the TCP protocol in detail or anything like that. It is also not about distributed algorithms. We will not study reliable broadcast or anything similar. So, what is it all about then? So, it's about network programming. We will study different ways to write programs communicating between different nodes. And communicating in different ways means we will study different communication paradigms. That is the scope of the course. So, which communication paradigms will be studied? We will look at sockets, both blocking sockets and non-blocking sockets. We will look at remote method invocation, where an object in one node can call a method in an object on another node. We will look at message queues, where we have a backend that promises reliable delivery of messages. We will study web applications, that is HTTP-based communication and application servers. And we will study Android clients communicating between each other and with backend servers. So those are the different communication paradigms that are studied in the course. For each of those communication paradigms, we will have a look at their strengths and weaknesses, when they should be used and when they should not be used. We will look at threads, how to use threads with the different paradigms. We will have a look at code organization, how to create an appropriate layered architecture for each of the paradigms. And we will most certainly write programs using the different paradigms. You can say that the first four bullets here, strengths and weaknesses, when to use them, when not to use them, threading, code organization, and so on, are the most important things. Such non-functional requirements must be handled properly, or the programs we write will be useless. But on the other hand, no one is paying us for knowing when to use or not to use a certain paradigm unless we can write an appropriate program actually using it. So what in the end evaluates us is, of course, the programs, and therefore there is a lot of emphasis on programming in this course, but programming with taking care of the four different bullets above. Next, let's have a look at the course layout. So all course material is here on the course site in Canvas. The course layout is presented here at the home page and describes in detail how the course is organized. So I will not go through everything here. I urge you to read it and to ask if you have any questions. So I will just give a few highlights of a few important things. First of all, this is very much an online course. All lectures are recorded. There will be no lectures given in class except the first lecture. And also, all programming assignments are submitted online here in Canvas. So there is no oral reporting of any homework. The only time you meet the teacher is during the tutorials. So there are about two sessions per week with two-hour tutorials where you will meet the teacher and have an opportunity to ask questions. So there is no new material, actually no material at all presented during the tutorials. There will just be a teacher present who will be there to answer your questions. You are also welcome to ask questions here in Canvas at the discussions page. Then I will explain the subcourses, how the course is divided into parts. There are two subcourses, the homeworks part, which is called INL1, and the project part, which is called 10.1. So the homeworks part consists of five programming assignments that are to be solved, and you are to write a report about your solution and submit the report in Canvas. And your code shall be available in a Git repository. Then there is the project part, 10.1, which consists of a larger programming assignment, the project, for which you should also place your code in the Git repository. In the project subcourse, there is also a written exam that is related to your project work. So the grading of the subcourses and the final grade is explained here, and is also explained on the pages with instructions for homeworks and project. I urge you also to read these pages with instructions for the assignments. The written exam is explained on this page, written exam. The exam is presented here. This is exactly the exam you will get. The questions are here, and you will see that they are related to your project work. So on the assignments page, you find all programming assignments, all the homeworks and the project. So there are 6 mandatory submissions, the 5 homeworks and the project. The project proposal is an optional assignment that you can do if you want feedback on the program you are thinking to write for your project before you start writing. On the modules page, you can find the lectures and again the assignments. So the course is divided into different modules. Each module contains specific programming paradigm. And for each paradigm, for example the sockets, there are lectures and homeworks. On the homeworks page, you find the task you are supposed to solve for that homework. And at the lectures page, you find video recordings of all the lectures. And if there are slides, there are not so many slides in this course, but some of the videos contain a slide presentation, and in that case, the slides can also be found on this page. For example, here, there is a small presentation on sockets. All sample code is available in the course GitHub repository, to which there are links on these lecture pages here, for example. Right, that was the course layout. As I said, I urge you to study it carefully and ask questions if you have any doubt.